Well, I think we'll get started here. You're all veterans, so you know that I'm going to say welcome to the Council on Foreign Relations. Will you turn off all your gizmos, please? Not just on vibrate, but cell phones, Blackberries, da-da-da. This meeting is on the record, so no complexities there. I'm Bob Blackwill. I'm a senior fellow here at the Council, and the purpose of this session is for us to describe to you the book, and you've got a little blurb on it, that we senior fellows at the Council have produced on the Iranian nuclear program. As you'll see when you buy it, for $3 from Amazon or Barnes & Noble or whatever, the book looks at, and we'll discuss some parts of it tonight, but not all of it, the current status of the Iranian nuclear program, as much as we know from the public record, the use of sanctions and their prospects, the potential for a negotiated settlement, the consequences of Israeli military action against the Iranian nuclear facilities and of U.S. military action, the prospects for regime change, the policies that should be considered by the United States if confronted with an Iran that has acquired either a latent or an actual nuclear weapons program, and then some final thoughts about how to think about the subject. Now, we did this book because all of us were struck by the degree of advocacy that now surrounds this subject. And almost everyone has a strong prescriptive opinion about what to do about the Iranian nuclear program. So you'll see in this volume, there are no prescriptions. There's no ideology, there's no partisanship. It's just our best effort to analyze the pros and cons of various steps the United States might take to deal with the Iranian program. And that's what we're going to do tonight. And we're going to do the first half. We'll hold forth. And then we'll open it up to you all for your comments and questions. So that's how we're going to proceed. So let me first say, and I'm sure you know my colleagues, but Elliott Abrams and Rob Danin and Richard Falkenrath, all senior fellows here at the Council. So we'll be epigrammatic, just to give time for you all to interact with us and set us straight. And we're going to begin with Rich Falkenrath on the current state of the Iranian program and its relationship to the negotiation that, as you know, began in 2 months ago in Istanbul, went on to Baghdad, and now will be going on to Moscow. So, Rich, start us off, please.
Thank you very much, Bob. It's a real pleasure and honor to be here. Starting with the current state of the program that we know about. And after I talk about what we know about, I'll talk about what we assess and then what we don't know. But what we know about is their fuel cycle production. And they have a uranium enrichment complex.
Rich, can you push the mic closer to you?
The Iranians have a uranium enrichment complex that consists of a few thousand centrifuges, which they procured in violation of their IAEA and NPT commitments from the AQCON network. These are centrifuges of Belgian design from the early 60s, and they are operating at two places. The largest facility at the moment is in Natanz, that is a mostly above-ground facility, and there's a second facility at Fordo, which is a below-ground hardened facility. At the moment, the best assessment we have is they have produced 6.2 tons of 3.5% enriched uranium. That is called low-enriched uranium. That is insufficient to make a bomb. You need high-enriched uranium, 90% U-235, in order to make a bomb. If they were to continue enriching their current stockpile of low-enriched uranium, we believe they have enough fission material for 5 crude gun assembly implosion devices, or implosion devices. They can't do it with the material they have right now. They would have to continue to run it through their centrifuges in order to bring the enrichment level higher. But to get naturally uranium, which is merely 0.7% U-235 to 3.5%, requires a great deal of energy and work. And the fact is, most of the distance has already been surmounted. And it would take a small number of months, 3 to 4, if they were to alter the operation of their existing centrifuges to bring the low-enriched uranium to high enrichment levels. It would take 3 to 4 months. They can do that right now, but we would have a warning if they did so, because we have IAEA inspectors at both facilities, and they would either see the change in the operation or they would be thrown out. And so there would be some number of months of warning if they were to attempt to do that. About this part of the program, there's actually fairly precise and non-controversial information. They've also enriched some quantity, we don't know exactly how much, to an intermediate level, which is about 19.5%, which is really quite close to 90. It's not a linear curve, it's sort of an asymptotic curve to 90% enrichment. The part that is more of an assessment, where the knowledge is far less precise, is weaponization. And to build a nuclear bomb requires a lot more than having fissile material. Fissile material is a sine qua non. You cannot have a bomb without it. But there are a lot of other things you need in addition. You need a design, you need firing devices, advanced electronics, and you need specialized, shaped, high-explosive charges that bring the fissile material together in the right geometry and the right velocity to produce nuclear yield. And on this question, this is a complicated question. It is one where the external signature when a country proceeds in weaponization is limited, meaning intelligence communities are often ignorant of what's going on, and their assessments often have large error bars. The U.S. intelligence community assessed in 2007 that Iran had been working on the weaponization part of a nuclear bomb until 2003, and then in 2003, decided to halt that work. That was a very controversial NIE. It was reaffirmed in principle in 2010. What we know is that they have a basic bomb design, again acquired through the same clandestine network, and they have scientists with the necessary skills to do this, and they have suspicious activities going on at a number of military bases that may or may not be about weaponization. And the assessment is that they are hedging their ability to build a bomb. They're putting in place the capabilities to do this on relatively short notice, that is, in a matter of months, to assemble basic workable device, but are stopping short of actually bolting it together and producing it. That's the assessment. Now, what we don't know is what we don't know. We don't know if they already have another bomb somewhere else, they have another design ready to go, or if they have another fissile material production facility hidden somewhere else in a quite large country, either almost certainly uranium enrichment. It's hard to hide plutonium production. This is not academic. This has happened to us before. It happened in North Korea, and it happened in Iraq, where a country who we were watching rather closely with and had a both cases, military conflict with, of course, in Korea, it's obeyed by an armistice, carried out clandestine uranium enrichment without our knowledge. So it is possible for a country to have covert, but we don't know this in this case. So that's the state of the program. Currently, right now, today, if a little bit of additional enrichment activity were to occur, enough fissile material for 5 nuclear weapons, and a technical capability, we think, in relatively short order to assemble it into a viable device. On the diplomacy, the prospects for success, that's the topic of my paper. Success has a number of different definitions. And my training and original involvement in these issues at the National Security Council was in the nonproliferation world. And nonproliferation, people look at this in a rather specific and technical way and define success as, does the outcome of the agreement lead to a dependable extension of the weaponization timetable for a country? Does it actually make it harder and require them to spend more money and take more time to get the bomb than it did before the agreement was done? And that's a rather technical and specific objective of definition of success. Now, there are other definitions of success you may want to apply to these talks, which we'll talk about in a minute. But I would tell you on this one, is will the timetable of Iranian weaponization be reliably extended by these talks? There's really no evidence, there's really no indication whatsoever that the Iranian government is prepared to commit to the sort of undertakings that would give us as nonproliferation experts confidence that their timetable is being extended. There are things they could do that would do that. For instance, if we did a deal with them whereby they continued to enrich uranium, as they assert is an element of their national sovereignty, but then we exported it from the country and took custody of it, that would make a difference, because enriched uranium is a prerequisite to a bomb. But if they merely, for instance, agreed to stop all enrichment levels at 20%, with no cap on the total amount of uranium that would be enriched to 20%, that would make no difference whatsoever. A suspension of enrichment operations completely, which is the current requirement on Iran, as imposed by a Chapter 7 resolution of the United Nations Security Council, would make a difference if they had just stopped it all. Right now, then they wouldn't, unless there's something we don't know about, they would not have the raw material to make a bomb. And that is the formal objective of the P5+1 negotiating with Iran. And if Iran were to accept that, that would make a difference. Iran could hardly have been more categorical or consistent for the last decade in saying they are not going to accept that. That it's just not, they're never going to do it. And so miracles can happen. But you have to, at some point, listen to what the leadership of another country says and how they're saying it and believe it. And in this case, my reading of this says there really is a no prospect that the Iranian government will accept a deal that extends their nuclear weaponization timetable, which then leads to another set of questions, which is, what are we really trying to accomplish from these talks, and what is there significant in the larger strategic engagement with Iran? And I think that is something that my colleagues and the other authors of the chapters address.
Thank you, Rich. I wrote the chapter on a U.S. attack on Iran and tried to examine the objectives of such an attack and the pros and cons of such an attack. So let me, again, apologize for the epigrammatic character of this. Let's imagine an American president decided to direct the U.S. military to attack Iran's nuclear facilities and associated targets. Why would he make such a decision? And I'll tick them off very briefly. First, he must have concluded that the Iranian latent or actual nuclear weapons capability would deeply compromise U.S. vital national interests. Two, that he would have made a judgment that, and this draws on what Rich just said, that the Iranian program had reached a stage in which breakout could happen so fast that it was, again, deeply injurious to American vital national interests. Third, that neither sanctions nor negotiations held the promise to find an acceptable solution to this problem. And what our volume argues is, as Rich just said, is the criterion is simple. Does the agreement push out the timeline that it would take Iran to acquire nuclear weapons if it decided to break out? Simple criterion. The president would have decided that neither negotiations nor sanctions were going to produce that. Fourth, much in the news in the last week, that cyber and other covert means did not have the promise of pushing out that timeline, or at least sufficiently the promise. And finally, and the most complex, looking at the pros and cons, the net assessment of the effects of an American attack, the president would have to decide that there were more benefits than liabilities. Now, and again, just a word or two, what would be the objectives of a U.S. attack? It would be to set back for many years the Iranian nuclear program. And it's worth saying here parenthetically that, of course, no country has the capacity to stop that program in perpetuity, since Iran has the scientists and the technical capability to produce nuclear weapons, but the objective would be to push out that timeline. What would be the target set? Well, it would be, and Rich mentioned these some of these earlier, the hardened and partially buried uranium-enriched facility at Natanz and the Fordow uranium facility near Qom, which is in a mountain. The reactor under construction at Arak, the uranium conversion facility at Isfahan, possible nuclear reactors at Bushehr, whether they would attack or not, and whatever other sites, plus, of course, associated air defenses and whatever else the U.S. Air Force and Navy thought was necessary. How long would an attack last? Here is one of the many conundrums that we examine in the book. Of course, one would like, if you're the president, to have as brief an attack as possible in order to try to minimize the international reaction. Well, we did it and we're done. But that runs up again, runs up against the question of how long would the attack have to last in order to be confident that your objective had been met, that is to say, to push out the timeline for several years. A short attack is best internationally, politically. A longer attack of days, perhaps even weeks, might be required to reach the objective. What I want to just conclude with, because of time, the chapter, of course, much longer, is to look at what might be the Iranian reaction to an American attack. And I have to say in a sympathetic way, since I've written my op-ed myself over the years, but you'll notice that on the subject of the Iranian reaction, almost all who favor an American attack minimize the Iranian reaction, write op-eds, and almost all who oppose an Iranian attack maximize. This is, as Mr. Brezhnev used to say, this is not a coincidence, comrade. So let me just, I'm not going to now say what the Iranians would do. There's an extended discussion of this in the book, just how to think about what the Iranians would do, but I will do the escalatory ladder. And I'm going to do it more quickly than it's done in the, first of all, they of course would stop nuclear negotiations with the West if the United States attacked, and then they would try to mobilize the area the region against us with governments and draw on the Arab Street and so forth. The next stage of the escalatory ladder might be missile attacks from Hamas and Hezbollah against Israel, trying to draw Israel into the war. If that didn't work, then even missile attacks from Iran against Israel, and Iran has many medium-range missiles that could easily attack Israel. Then sort of the next is sort of category would be against American interests more directly. That will, of course, that would be increasing support for Taliban in Afghanistan, increasing support for Shia terrorism against U.S. facilities and people in Iraq, and even targeting U.S. military facilities in the Gulf, or trying to close the Straits of Hormuz as we go up the escalatory ladder. And then finally, which I would regard as the top of the escalatory ladder, would be attacks in the American homeland, which could be carried out by the extensive Hezbollah infrastructure, which is already in Mexico and other Latin American countries. The last thing I want to say about this is Persians fight long wars. Read Herodotus. So I don't know where the escalatory ladder would go immediately, and I don't know what the American administration would do to the escalatory ladder in response, but this would probably go on for quite a long time. So next, my colleague Elliott Abrams is going to talk about regime change as a part, a dimension of this complexity.
Thanks, Bob. I will try to be brief. Why do we talk about regime change? I think the answer is because our efforts over, 30 years to change the policies of the Islamic Republic have not succeeded, not with respect to their support for terrorism, their attitude toward the U.S., their nuclear program. So the question then arises, well, if you can't get them to change your policies, why don't we get rid of this regime? Why not try regime change? First question that follows on that is, would it make a difference? That is, would a different regime behave differently? And there is the frequent statement that the nuclear program, as you know, did not begin under this regime. It began in some form under the Shah. I would argue that it's hard to say that there is an eternal hostility between the United States and Iran. I mean, under the Shah, we were allies, not enemies. We don't have border disputes or other conflicts of that sort that suggest that any regime in Iran is going to be locked in hostility with the United States the way this one is now. So I think there's a fair argument that it would make a difference, and the question then becomes, why not try it? What do we mean by trying a policy of regime change? Do we mean creating instability and violence in Iran? Do we mean arming Iranian minority groups or anti-regime elements? There are a number of arguments, I think, that present themselves against such a policy. first of all, it might fail. That is, do we really believe that we have the tools to make such a policy succeed? Do we know enough about Iran to know what would cause it to succeed? Secondly, do we know what the impact of trying would be? That is, one could argue that trying it would produce even worse conduct on the part of the regime. We're challenging regime survival. They're presumably their top interest, and they have a number of ways of responding. In a sense, it's the escalatory ladder that Bob mentioned, if we try and even if we fail. Thirdly, even if we succeeded over time, it might take too long. What we're talking about here is mostly the Iranian nuclear program. As Rich said, this is not a program that needs 5 years to get to fruition if they step on the gas pedal. So a multi-year program, even that produced regime change, could be taking effect too late. And meanwhile, we would probably or likely destroy the international coalition that we have built, we see in the P5 plus one sanctions against Iran. So does that mean we should do nothing with respect to the regime? There, I think there we should look at the spectrum of possibilities. And one that we ought at least to look at and to remember is our relationship with the Soviet Union, particularly in the last, 10 years of the Cold War, where we did constrain Soviet conduct. We did present a military and ideological challenge. We did say we hoped and thought the regime would fail, but we didn't undertake the narrowly defined kind of regime change efforts, trying to create violent rebellions against the regime inside Russia. What did we do? Well, we blunted their ability to use foreign and military successes to prove what a great regime they had and to cow their own domestic population, mostly in the Third World. We did not use economic sanctions. We actually improved economic relations with the Soviet Union in the last 10 or 20 years of its existence. We did challenge them ideologically. We had a pretty strong ideological element, really from the start to the finish in our challenge to the Soviet Union. That's another difference with respect to Iran. Our efforts with respect to Iran here are very modest. If you look at the State Department budget, we're spending $1,200,000 a year on democracy promotion and related programs, which is not a very large amount of money in Washington. So there's no broad challenge, and that challenge has not increased since June 2009. What might we do? Again, there is a spectrum here. We could heat up the rhetoric, talk about the lack of freedom, the cost of the regime to Iranians, their support for terror. We could try to deepen or create a pariah status for the regime, challenge the ideological basis of the whole regime. We can try to break through what the president has called the electronic curtain, that is internet access and better broadcasting. Now, we do this. We have such internet programs. We have Persian language broadcasting, but it would be hard to say that we couldn't do more and do it more successfully if we made a decision to pursue this path. Is that regime change? Well, it's a definitional question. Is regime change where you get people to shoot at regime officials, or is regime change where you have a 10-year plan to undermine the regime ideologically? We have not pursued that highly activist approach. We have not done zero. We do have programs. There are not very large and expensive programs. The job today, really, is to judge what the risks and rewards of these various forms of regime change might be and what are our chances of success in shortening the life of the regime in this context of a nuclear, diplomatic, and economic confrontation with Iran.
Thank you, Elliott. Now, Rob, our final presentation, Rob Danin will look at sort of American policy options if Iran were to acquire a latent or actual nuclear weapons capability.
Well, thank you, Bob, and thank you, everyone. It's a pleasure to be here. Let me just, rather than sort of go through my whole chapter, echo Bob's sentiment and say, buy the book. But really, let me just say the following. I mean, there's a tendency to look at or assume that Iran, with a nuclear weapon or the capacity to assemble one rapidly, would lead to one of two outcomes. One is either an immediate exchange of nuclear weapons, a nuclear exchange, or immediately a deterrent relationship that is stable and effectively leads to little change in the Middle East as we know it. I think both of these are overstated, and that the likely outcome is to see a very inherently unstable Middle East. Iran with nuclear weapons is likely to be more assertive, seeking to extend its leverage over its neighbors and the region. It can do so in a number of different arena, ranging from threatening the supply of and the flow of oil through the Straits of Hormuz, seeking to increase its regional dominance, seeking to destabilize its neighbors or affect those countries in which there are Shia populations, be it Iraq, Afghanistan, Lebanon, Saudi Arabia, Bahrain. There will likely be a greater impulse to use conventional weapons in the belief that they have a certain degree of deterrence from retaliation, from conventional retaliation. Iran with nuclear weapons does lead to greater room for miscalculation in the region and therefore a more dangerous region and greater possibility for conventional warfare. Now, what does it mean more broadly? Iran having acquired the nuclear weapons will be a blow to American standing in the region. Having sought to prevent Iran from gaining such weapons, the U.S. will have been demonstrated to have failed. But it won't just be the United States. It will be the Security Council of the United Nations. It will be the non-proliferation regime under the NPT that will have been dealt a serious, if not fatal, blow. Iran will have used the NPT to develop conventional or rather a peaceful nuclear capabilities and then use that veneer to then go to nuclear status, nuclear weapon status along the lines that Rich Falkenrath just described earlier. How will neighbors in the region react? Well, for many in the region, there's a debate. Will it seek to move closer to Iran or move closer to Iran's enemies? I'd say in the Middle East this is a false choice, and in many ways you're likely to see both happen simultaneously. States will seek to appear to be less hostile to Iran, and you'll see a lot of increased shuttles to Tehran to kiss the ring, metaphorically speaking, and at the same time greater running to other world capitals to see what might be done to balance against what is perceived as a greater Iranian threat. How will Israel react? Obviously no one knows, but I think there will be an increased impulse to want to act unilaterally. It will be disappointed in the United States and be all the less apt to want to rely further on the United States, and it will want to reestablish its regional strength, and that could be destabilizing in the short term in the rest of the region. I mean, we are likely to see an arms race in the region, although that, of course, will take time. And the fact that it will take time, as other states seek to gain their own nuclear weapons capabilities, will add to the inherent instability of the situation as new balance of powers emerge. So how will the United States deal with this? I think the United States will have no choice but to seek to constrain Iranian room for behavior. That will lead the United States to have to issue a very clear declaratory policy that Iran will not be allowed to use any such weapons or move to nuclear alert status, that it cannot transfer its weapons know-how or capabilities or arsenal to any third parties. The U.S. will need to increase the missile defense capabilities of its partners in the region, and it will have to ultimately raise the price for Iran's behavior. So Iran, in short, with the bomb, will drastically change the Middle East. The regime will feel emboldened and prone to increase its efforts to stir up Shiite populations and trouble elsewhere. And it may be feel emboldened to exert its influence in other ways, including militarily. A nuclear Iran would act, however Iran would act, the neighbors would feel more vulnerability, and the incentive for them to attack Iran before it grew even stronger or attained its own second strike capability would only increase. The only way to mitigate this danger, short of rolling back Iran's nuclear arsenals along the way that Elliott and Bob described, would be economic and political strategy and military of led by the United States of depriving Iran of the benefits or the perceived benefits of its nuclear status. Rather than withdrawing from the Gulf, the emergence of an Iran with nuclear weapons would require the U.S. to redouble its commitment to countering the Iranian threat.
Thank you, Rob. All right, over to you all. So can you raise your hand? And then when you get the, I think a mic is on its way, could you stand up, say your name and any professional affiliation you might have? So this gentleman here.
Thank you. My name is Chris Isham with CBS. Question for Rich Falkenrath. You mentioned briefly the 2007 NIE from the CIA, and which was upheld recently in 2010. Is it your view that that the evidence that you're aware of supports the conclusion that the essentially that the effort was abandoned in 2003 to acquire nuclear weapons?
It's a excellent question. It's a difficult one for me to answer, so I'm going to answer it by constructing the history and what is publicly known about it, which is that the Iran has had a nuclear program of one kind or another for decades. The acceleration of the Islamic Republic's Islamic Republic's nuclear program occurred after they were the victim of repeated chemical weapons attacks by the Iraqis. And it proceeded covertly through the course of the mid-'80s into the 90s, including by constructing a clandestine procurement network to acquire the equipment needed to do it. The there were a few sort of setbacks and fits and starts of that, but the assessment is that once they saw the United States invade Iraq and the sort of power that we unleashed in that situation and the willingness, I think, of President Bush to use force quite preventively. This wasn't a preemptive attack like the Six-Day War. This was a preventive attack. The assessment was that that caused them to rethink how quickly they were conducting their covert nuclear weapons research and instead focus on building the uranium enrichment complex. The only part that I can say with confidence about where they are now is that we will have low confidence in whatever assessment the intelligence community brings to the White House, which is that this is, when you're talking about weaponization of small numbers and compartmentalized programs in hard targets to get to, this is a very low signature activity, and it is inherently high error bar and can go either way. And your odds of not knowing that it's happening are greater in many respects than your odds of knowing it's happening, if it does happen, which is a really difficult spot to be both the intelligence briefer, bringing the data forward to the policymaker, and the policymaker receiving it. If you were to go back and look at a commission on ballistic missile defense that was carried out at the end of the Clinton administration, chaired by Don Rumsfeld, it had a very similar analytic point, which is there are certain strategic threats that when they develop, we have high confidence that we will have high confidence when we see them or don't see them. And there are other strategic threats which when they develop, we have no reason to believe we'll have high confidence either way. And this issue of Iranian weaponization, meaning the in-the-lab assembly of a design and high explosives and electronics into a configuration that can produce nuclear yield when mated with an adequate quantity of fissile material metal, that is a very, very low signature item on which none of us can have a whole lot of confidence.
Barbara Slavin from the Atlantic Council, where I write reports on Iran. Couple of points of fact. Mr. Falkenrath, Iran did suspend major elements of its program from 2003 to 2005 when it was negotiating with the Europeans. So your statement that they have never suspended is not correct. They've also repeatedly said, although not lately, I must admit, that they would stop or cap their uranium enrichment at 5% in return for various concessions. So that's just a point of fact. Mr. Blackwell, do you consider at all in your report what the impact would be? You're talking just about Iran, but you can't talk about Iran in isolation from a region that is already in turmoil. Do you talk at all about what the impact would be of a U.S. or Israeli strike on Iran now when much of the Middle East is essentially in play and when Iran is not so popular because of its support for the Syrian regime, and how seriously should we take that? And then one also for Elliott. You mentioned that during the last 10 years of the Cold War, we increased our contacts with the Soviet Union. We traded more with them. We sent more people there. They sent more people here. Aren't you concerned that the current policy of increasing sanctions and isolation may actually prolong the life of this regime? Thank you.
Well, let me go first, but and I think they're excellent questions, and seek to draw us into prescription, which we will not be drawn into. We will not be drawn into, although we have our own views privately, but the whole point of this book is not to indulge in the kind of prescription inside the Beltway that has reached flood tide. On your question about the effect in the region, yes, the book looks at that. And again, analytically, one can have theories, but they're only theories. And advocacy treats theories as if they're facts. By the way, that's Aristotle, so it isn't even Blackwill. So it's a theory, and I think there's some logic to it that in a situation of an Israeli or American attack, it could further excite and ignite the forces that are already there. But it's just a theory. And a president, what I tried to say was that a president in doing a net assessment would, his net assessment would be inadequate if he did not look carefully at that issue, for sure, and put it up against a dozen other issues. But having read intelligence from the DI, Director of Intelligence, for very long time, it's difficult too for them to tell a president, well, if you do this, this is going to happen, because we get surprised so often on both sides. Now, Elliott will not be drawn into a prescriptive response to your question.
However, I think what one can say is that the goals are somewhat different in the sense that there is a very broadly supported international goal with respect to Iran, which is not to overthrow the regime. It is to stop a nuclear weapons program. And that really is a very broad, it's not just the P5 plus one. There's broader support in the Security Council and in the IAEA Board of Governors. We didn't have a narrow short-term goal like that with respect to the Soviet Union. We had a broad long-term goal of hoping that that regime would come to an end. So I think it's apples and oranges.
Back in the back.
My name is Peter Baumbusch. I'm a retired lawyer. My question is to Richard Falkenrath. You were discussing the things that would allow for the extension of time before weaponization. And the one thing you said was, well, if they stop their nuclear weapons program altogether, we know that will extend the time. But you suggest that there might be other things, other than the full suspension of the program, that might extend the time. For example, you talked about a cap, very briefly, on the 20% enrichment. Are there other things, other than the full suspension of the program, that would extend the time for weaponization?
Yes. First of all, I don't believe I said the cap on 20% would make a difference. In fact, in the book, I write that I think that would make no difference if they were unlimited in the amount of 20% uranium they could produce. But if the agreement were merely that they enriched no uranium above 20% U-235, but had no limit on the amount of uranium, natural uranium, that they could bring to that level, then in my judgment it would have no material impact on their long-term weaponization timetable, because that 20% enrichment would have such a quantity of what we call separative work units. This is the standard internationally accepted unit of enrichment activity, that the final step to 90 is quite low. So what would make a difference? No enrichment would make a difference. and enrichment with full extraction from the country would make a difference. Enrichment with, say, vitrification would make a difference, which is to put the enriched uranium in a chemical state that was not easily accessible, which is the case for, say, the plutonium coming out of Bushehr. Bushehr comes out, it's in a chemically and radiologically inaccessible form for quite a period of time until reprocessed, and they don't have the reprocessing capability to do that, and the Russians have committed to take it back. So there is fissile material emerging from the reactors operating at Bushehr. It's just inaccessible to them, and it's not ideal. So there are things to do like this, but there are other things which are pixie dust that make you think they're actually limiting but are not. And the main one which has been bandied about is a simple restriction on enrichment level without a restriction on mass of uranium enriched.
Can I just two fingers?
There aren't any two fingers. Sorry. Barbara, there are no two fingers, okay? But if we have time, we'll get back to you. I want to spread it around if I could. Maybe everybody else is so compelled by your two fingers that they want to hear it. Okay, all right, we'll get you. Okay, we have a question here. But we'll try to get back to you. It's a large audience.
Amitai Tsioni, George Washington. I want to understand one thing again, since you're not allowed to prescribe. What does it mean when a country can be 3-4 months away from assembling all the elements, and we have very low confidence in the intelligence? What is this combination?
No, so here, the analogy in fact, there's a lot of countries in this situation, Japan or Germany. Japan and Germany are a few months from having a nuclear weapon. There's no reason to believe they want to. Right? But they certainly have the means to do it. And they have the fissile material at their disposal to do it. Plutonium in the case of Germany, highly enriched uranium in the case of Japan. And we just don't think they will. My point is, a country that is highly secretive, whom we aren't really collecting against, which is a hard target, that final choice to take a quantity of separated fissile material and turn it into a bomb is something which our intelligence community might get, but also might not. And when you were putting a confidence bar on how likely we are to get it, it's on the lower end. Alternatively, the actual production of the material turns out to be a relatively high signature thing. It's still instructive that we missed it in Iraq in 91 and North Korea in the mid-90s. But it is relatively higher signature, and we have higher confidence of noticing that than we do weaponization. The third element in the equation is delivery vehicles. And those turn out to be extremely high signature in general for the conventional ones, mainly ballistic missiles, which is every time someone tests a ballistic missile, you can read about it in Jane's or whatever. You sort of know it. And we have ships at sea who collect the telemetry that they're sending back to their ground stations to see how the missile worked, and we analyze it, and we can understand. That's a very high signature activity. But weaponization occurs in small little labs hidden away using lots of small numbers of people and lots of materials that could be going anywhere. And my point is a technical one, which says, in that question, which was the centerpiece of 2007 NIE, it is a really tough one for any intelligence community to have high confidence on.
Accent must prevent you from hearing my question. My question was, when you're 3 months away from enrichment and you have low confidence, what conclusion follows from that combination?
I think maybe I won't do any better, but let me give it a shot. If Iran takes the low enriched uranium it has now with its technical capacity, if it were to so choose, it could produce about 5 nuclear weapons, and we would know it through the IAEA inspectors watching it, or because they expel the IAEA inspector. So we know enough about their technical capability to know, should they make that choice, we would know that they were underway in enriching to 90%. High confidence. Would we have high confidence that we knew when they made the decision? No, hard target? Would we have high confidence that in parallel they were working on weaponization in small labs and so forth? No. But on the narrow but crucial question of necessary but not sufficient, we would know if by the production from 3.5 to 90% that they were underway in enriching to a nuclear weapons capability.
Exactly right, unless they have a secret enrichment facility we don't know about.
Unless that. Is that, did we get?
Make it.
Okay, thank you. Here, we'll have up close and then back.
Marvin Foer with APAC in Washington. Some of the Iranian facilities that you spoke about, Richard, started out as covert facilities and then were revealed and became known to the public. We've seen in recent years a further discovery of additional Iranian facilities that were covert. But it seems that our government believes that they have a handle on these kinds of major facilities, that they don't really believe that the Iranians could have a major covert program, apart from the types of weaponization activities you're talking about, that the chances of a major enrichment facility or other facilities that could parallel what we know about are low. Could you assess that kind of assertion from our government? You talked about Iran being a large country, and we know they've tried in the past to do this. Do you share the confidence that our government has in our ability to know the types of activities that could be going on?
I can't speak for the government, but I think the odds of them having a hidden covert enrichment facility are low for a reason I'll describe. And the odds of them having a hidden plutonium production facility somewhere else are basically zero because of running reactors generates a lot of energy. On the enrichment facility, the reason is we now actually know a lot about their covert uranium enrichment program. And one of the, you know, while they had periodically suspended certain activities at the declared IAEA facilities, they'd never suspended their clandestine procurement network, which bought two generations of centrifuges from a rogue Pakistani scientist who had stolen them from Uranco, the Belgian enrichment firm, when he worked there in the 70s. So the first generation is one that actually is a pretty bulky old centrifuge that they had some technical problems installing and getting working and couldn't get the enrichment working until 2007. Unfortunately for them, fortunately for us, that network was exposed in 2003. And suddenly, in 2003, while we were fairly preoccupied in Iraq, we got a deluge of new intelligence about what the Iranians had really been up to and who AQ Khan's other customers had been, including the Iranians. That was the first generation of centrifuge, and they actually did have to pause the installation and operation of those because they couldn't get them to quite work right. In parallel, however, they were procuring the second generation of faster, higher efficient centrifuges from AQ Khan and installing them in a new facility they were digging in a mountain that Bob described that is essentially immune from external attack. So they had two simultaneous covert procurement programs going on simultaneous. I suppose it's not inconceivable they had a third, and they were that redundant and that paranoid on it. But it looks to us like they had a pretty aggressive, complex, comprehensive clandestine enrichment procurement network underway, and they got found out. Whether they managed somehow in the midst of all that to have yet a third compartmentalized that we didn't notice at all, I don't know, but I think it's unlikely. North Korea was a different deal. We were totally, it was the drunk looking for his wallet under the lamppost, which is we saw a reactor and we negotiated to shut down that reactor where they were separating plutonium for a long time. And they agreed for a while and took some food and fuel oil aid as a result of that. And meanwhile, bought the exact same centrifuges from AQ Khan that he was also selling to Iran and installed them in another place. Well, that came to light about the same time.
Sir.
Amir Afkhami, George Washington University's Department of Psychiatry and Behavioral Sciences. I had a question for all of you. One was, have you addressed the Iranian behavioral approach to negotiations? What I mean by that is the Iranian mentality that a negotiation is not over until it's over. To give you an anecdote, when I was a kid walking in a bazaar and my dad bought a rug, he basically paid for the rug, and he came to collect it the next day. And the merchant looked at him and said, listen, Mr. Afghami, the price of the dollar to the Toman has changed, so here's your money back. Let's go to the bargaining table. And sort of piggybacking on the question of whether you've addressed Iranian negotiating techniques, in a country where ultimately decisions on a policy level are based on incentives, and thereby, and because incentives can change day by day or month by month, how can you deal with a regime that ultimately might change its position from one day to the next? And how can you, why is it that regime, nonviolent regime change is such a dirty word in our political system, since ultimately even a negotiated outcome is a time-limited factor in Iran? I mean, after all, Solidarnosc did not emerge in a vacuum. So why is Iran treated as an exceptional country? Thank you.
Well,
sorry.
I think it's an excellent question, and the answer is no, basically. We didn't look with any sophistication or complexity about of the cultural influences on Iranian negotiating behavior, although it's a very important question. For those of you, and I assume it's all of you, who are going to buy the book, you'll find out it's only 90 pages long. And one of the things we confined ourselves to, which is 3,000 words or so per chapter, it won't look like a series of foreign affairs articles or Daedalus. We tried to make it accessible to folks who care a lot about this issue, American citizens and experts, but don't want to read a 400-page book. If it had been longer, that certainly would have been a chapter, because I think it's so important. Second, and we're just almost out of time, we have a chance for one short question, one short answer, but we don't say anything denigrating about regime change. Elliott went through it. When you read this, it's analytical about the pros and cons of looking at regime change as a policy option for the United States.
I would just want to add one thing, which is that for those who want a wonderful insight into this question, there's the famous cable from the U.S. Embassy that happened to come a day or two before the hostage taking, signed out by Chargé Bruce Langan about Iranian negotiating style. You can Google it and get it on the internet. And it's, short cable length, and discussing the style of negotiating that our diplomats in Tehran had found trying to deal with the revolutionary government in its early days.
Okay, we'll have a last question here, sir. You've...
But I'll have one anyway. Arnie Podgorski, Future Pipe Industries. The question is so blunt, I apologize for it. We haven't spoken about deliverability. If they develop one of these things, can they get it here?
There's two ballistic missiles.
Right now, they have no ICBM. They have a lot of ballistic missiles in Iran. They have no ICBM. They have medium-range ballistic missiles that can comfortably reach southeastern Europe and Israel and their neighbors, but they don't have one that can reach. They have a space program that could eventually become that, but it's a three-stage rocket. I mean, actually, Frank Klotz, who's a real expert on the stuff, is right behind you, also a senior fellow counsel for it. Not a trivial technical matter. And then building a warhead which can survive the aerodynamic effects of entry into the atmosphere at a very high velocity, also not a trivial matter. North Koreans have flubbed it again and again. Now, there are unconventional means of delivery, you know, shipping cane or whatever, but those are sort of scenario. Usually you want to put these things on a fighter, and their air force is not that good, or on a ballistic missile. Everyone pretty much thinks it's going to be a ballistic missile. They've made such a massive investment in their IRBM and short-range ballistic missile capabilities that we think if they get around to it, they'll try to miniaturize it and put it on the top of one of those, typically.
Okay, well, we're out of time. I want to thank you all for coming, and I hope you'll have a chance to look at the book. But I also hope you've heard this evening how complex this issue is, and To follow up on one of the questions that you all asked, it might be said that unless Iran accepts entirely the current P5 plus one, which is based on the Security Council resolutions, which I think all of us think is unlikely, unless Iran does that, it might be said that there are only problematic options in dealing with this problem. And that anybody who says or writes that there's a simple answer to this, you should skip that op-ed and go to the next one. Because this is a bitch of a problem. It really is. Thank you for coming, and thank you all.